welcome to the Capital Discussions Trading Group 2. I'm Tom Nunamaker. Today is January 5th, 2016, so welcome, everyone. Andrew and I were just talking about the wild markets we've had, especially yesterday, and where things might be headed. I see Dan Harvey's here. We have a good crowd. Before we get started, I know, Andrew, you were talking about the mid price, so let me just share my screen for those of you who use IB. If you want to add the mid price, this is an easy way to do it. Let me know when you can see my screen.
Yeah, we can see it.
Okay, so if you just right click on one of these column things and just insert a column before the implied volatility and then price mid, and I'll just put it on here. So now I've got the mid price, but I personally like it to stand out. So I right click and go, who says the OCR mid column group right here, configure mid column, and it just changed the text to like a yellow. And now it shows up, it kind of stands out now. So if I'm looking for mid prices, there they are. So that's one I do just to keep it easy.
The one thing you have to be careful with mid prices in IB is if someone's working a bid or an offer, it'll skew the mid price away from what it really is.
Yeah, so you need to do stuff like the where is it, market depth, and see, you know, these bids are. Yeah, those one lots can definitely mess things up. I just wanted to share that real quick. So, you have some more people you have to promote.
One of the interesting things about yesterday is that the SPX made a marginal new low below that mid-December low, and yet the volatility was well below the high. You know, the VIX was well below the high it made last month.
Right.
So I don't know if that's a little hint about yesterday.
Well, I see Larry's here. Larry, I don't know if you're called in or not. If you are, can you hear us? I lost his phone connection. Now hopefully he'll bring it back. Okay, so what should we talk about today? Any volunteers or any questions from the group? See, the group's quite a bit. We're at 37 people today.
Tom, did we have Larry on board to show his credit spread system?
Larry is in the meeting, but I don't. Larry, can you hear us? Maybe type in the chat.
Hey, Larry, you need to either call in by phone or use a headset or a microphone on your computer.
Hey, Larry, I'll make you a attendee. And then I'll re-promote you, and you'll see that box to call in. That should do it. Here, I can get the number for you. Let's see. This is for Larry. Okay. Okay, hopefully Larry can call in. Hey, Dan, I was wondering, I'm doing that presentation tomorrow on the road trip trade. I was wondering if you're going to be around. Maybe you could join us. Okay, we're still waiting for Larry. While we're waiting, does anybody want to go over anything they're trading or how they reacted to the markets yesterday, good or bad?
Curtis just asked a question. Can you see it in the chat?
Oh, let me look. Oh, why is it called a road trip trade? Dan Harvey named it because that's the trade that he puts on when he goes on a road trip, because the first 30 days he really doesn't have much to do with it. It's at 1:30 your time.
Can you hear me? Okay, I'm getting feedback. I hear you through my computer, but I don't think I'm getting through to you.
Right
now,
I'm
on my cell phone.
Can you use headsets? Because I think you're getting a feedback loop.
Do you want me to turn down the volume on my computer?
Yep, give that a try.
Yeah, if you're using the phone, you have to turn off any speakers.
Okay, the speakers are off.
That sounds great.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, fine.
Oh, okay. What is it that you do? I had my name up there as a participant, you know, following the instructions, and it had 27 table. But I could hear you guys while you've been talking for the last 10 minutes, but I couldn't figure out how to get my voice in there.
Okay, well, you're in now. So I just made you the presenter. If you can share your desktop, maybe you can show us what you're doing.
Oh, okay. Would you like to see the spreadsheet that I've made? It's kind of a work in progress.
Yeah, absolutely. If you're on Windows, you can go Control Alt and then the letter D, like Delta, and that should be able to share your desktop.
Can you see it now?
Not yet. You need to share your screen.
How do I do? Get an Alt what?
It's Control Alt D, like Delta or desktop.
Does that do it?
Not yet.
I've got my spreadsheet on my screen.
Do you see on the WebEx Event Center, the quick start, there's a tab, and on there, there's a button that says share screen.
Yes, I do.
Okay,
click on that.
Yep, you bet. There we go.
It.
Okay, can you see my screen now?
I do.
Okay, can you see my granddaughter?
Yes. Nice looking girl.
Yeah, she is. She's a great kid. I'll try to put my spreadsheet up there and see if you all can see it.
Yep, we can see it.
Okay. Do you want me to explain what it is that I've been doing?
Yeah, that'd be great.
Okay. This spreadsheet is kind of a work in progress that I'm kind of going along. And you'll notice that I have a mirror account where I trade, but this is a paper trading account, but I have a mirror account. And I just used one spread just to keep things simple. And at the top here is a summary. And I think all my numbers are correct, but there could be some adjustments. But it shows what the return on capital for year to date was 499.2. Now, what's not in that number that I'll put in there for next year is the commission fees and any trade fees, which will probably lower that down about 20 or 30 points. I'm not sure which. And then the number of spreads that trades that I made and the weekly trades, 36 and 36 wins, so it's 100%. And what I do here is, let me go down to where it's kind of consistent a little bit, where I can find. Well, let's take a look at this right here in June, if you would. And all I'm doing, and it's kind of just, I just kind of developed this thing, and I really didn't think it was any big deal at the time, and maybe it isn't. But I started out by selling, and this is actually what I've kind of refined it as I've gone along, just selling the SPX vertical spreads, put spreads, STX put spreads. And the reasoning, my reasoning behind that was that it's what I, information that I was able to glean, that that is a very, very liquid area to trade in. I think in large part because the big guys play there, hedging their portfolios. So there's a lot of money in there. So I started out by doing 25 point spreads, as you see right here on the 24th of June, right here. And sold to open SPX vertical spread 2070, 2045. So that would be a $2,500 risk, and then an $80 credit. So, you know, I've had people raise the question to me, is this really the risk? And I don't know the answer to this yet. Is this really the risk, or is this the risk? Is it 2,500 minus 80? Is that the risk? So I just put this over here. But for the purposes of the calculations at the top, I use this number here. So it was $80 divided by $2,500.
Your actual risk is the value of the spread minus the credit.
So this would be the accurate number to use.
That's your actual risk if the market just crashed and went right through your spread. That's
okay.
The most you could lose.
Okay. So would it be accurate to divide the 80 by this here, not the 2420?
Well, it depends on what your margin requirements are. To quantify risk, I would say that your return based on what your margin requirements for the trade are.
Okay. Well, the way I determined this number right here, this it's 2020-1995. So the question is, why is it 2020? And that's another thing that I'm going to put into the new spreadsheet, and that is, what was the SPX at the time that I initiated the trade? So how did I arrive at that 2020? And what I was doing is using a standard deviation. And let me explain that I am not a mathematician by any stretch of the imagination. The things that I've learned over the years are just things with all kinds of holes that need to be filled in. So I took the SPX, whatever it was trading at, and I would take this a two standard deviation, 175, 1.5. I think there might have been one or two trades where I tried one, and they were successful, but, you know, it was taking on a greater risk. So then I moved to 1.5, and then I've kind of settled in to where I'm pretty much doing 2 and 1.75 standard deviations. So that's, of course, one way that we would define the risk. One person might say, you know, I'm just comfortable at 2. That's all the risk I want to take. Another person would say, you know, I'm willing to go at 175, another one at 150, and so on. So then the next question is, what's the amount of spread? And in this case here, you'll see that I used 2,500, where some people, and as I started to move toward the end of the year, you'll see where I started to get some here where there were 1,000. There's a 1,500 down here. So I started to experiment. Like down here, I got 1,500 and I got $60. I was okay with that. And up here on these thousands, you see I got 80, 80, 80, and I'm okay with that. So $80 on a thousand on a spread of 1,000 right here. So a large part of this last past year for me has been one of experimentation. What kind of risk do I want to take? What kind of premium can I get? And So that's all I really was doing, using two never higher than two standard deviations, and pretty much never lower than 1.5.
Hey, Larry, this is Tom Henley. Can I ask you a very quick question? You say you're using a two standard deviation, 1.35, or pardon me, 1.75, 1.5. Is that off of the yearly SD? Is that off of the monthly standard deviation or the weekly?
I take the table that I was using. For example, I don't know what the SPX is trading at now, but I would just take and plug that number in.
Okay.
Then the next thing I would do is take a look at the VIX and the implied volatility. Let me see if I can. So we have, can you see my screen?
Absolutely.
Okay. So I would take into my handy dandy little calculation thing, I would put in 2004.
Okay.
The next thing I would do is I'd go down here to the VIX, which is currently at 20.97.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would go over here to the, can you see the applied volatility, 22.7?
Yeah. Yeah.
The
yes,
highest,
indeed.
The highest of those two numbers.
Okay.
And then the number of days. And then I would hit enter on my handy dandy calculator, and that would give me the standard deviation.
So is that another spreadsheet that you're using, or do you have a calculator that you're using that's got this formula plugged into it?
Actually, it's one that I had subscribed to and still do until I ran across, I think it was on your website. Do you not have a standard deviation calculator?
Yeah, I just pasted the link in the chat. It's on the tools menu.
Yeah, I think that, let me take a look at this, because I have a friend of mine that's not very knowledgeable at this, and I'm not an Excel guy by any chance. I mean, I can do a couple things. But well, this is interesting. Let's just try this, if you don't mind. Does anybody have up? I don't have to go back. What is the SPX currently trading at?
SPX right now is 2004.85.
2004.89. 91. I don't round it off. I just need the first four numbers.
Use okay. 2005.
Use 2005.
Okay. All right. I got that. And
VIX is 20.91. 20.91. Yes.
Okay. And the implied volatility?
IV of the SPX is, let's see, I've got IV percent on here. I don't have IV. Let's switch over.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would go to this one here, 2261.
Okay. So you're looking at the Jan 2. You're looking at the current.
Yeah. So back to, I forgot what I said, 2261.
That sounds
and the
good.
Number. Number, yeah, the number
you got
of days.
Three.
Okay, so then I go here on your handy dandy calculator here, and we'll put in 2005. Hit the tab key and go over here, and I wipe this out. And we'll put in the highest of those two numbers is what I would do. So we got 22.61,
yep.
And then the number of days, of course, is 3. And I'm not quite sure why this is in here, but in any event, that takes us then. So then I would say, okay, let's just deal with 1.75, just to make this example. We'll take 1.75 standard deviation. And at 1.75 here, we have on the doesn't look like it's
your volatility.
Something's wrong with
your volatility is too high.
Yeah, you know what?
A decimal point in the wrong place.
We're looking at another flash crash.
Yeah. I have it on another sheet too. Let me take a look here. Just give me a second.
Type in 0.2261. See what you get.
0.22. Okay. 0.22.
Just move the cursor over and put the period in there.
0.22261. Okay, let's see what that is.
Hit return. There you go.
Okay, all right. So at 175, we would have 1933. So I could round that up or down. I would make it 1935. Okay.
And that would be your short strike?
Yes, it would be. So then I would go over here, drag this down to that area. And I would use 1935, so I would single click on that and drop it down here.
Okay.
And if we're going to use, let's just say for the sake of this example, that I'm going to use 25 point spread. So I would go up to 1910, hold the control key down, and that would give me, so there's $1.20 right there for 25 point spread for 3 days. Now, you know, I might fiddle around with this and say, well, that's pretty good spread. You know, so I'd say, what if I take that to 1915, what I get?
Mm-hmm.
That's
mm-hmm.
a buck. So I tighten that a little bit, and it's a buck. You know, so one person might say, you know, that's okay. I'm happy with that. So how about if we take it to 1910? No, I'm going the wrong direction. How about if we take it to 1920, right?
Okay.
That's 85 cents. So one person might say, I'm happy with 85 cents. That's a 15 point spread, 85 cents. I'm comfortable with that. Now, typically what I do is that I'll take and usually I'll put in another nickel. And I'd say about 85% of the time I'll get that nickel. But if I don't, I don't chase a trade. I never chase a trade. You know, I may alter that later on depending what the market, but I'm just not going to chase it every 5 minutes.
Okay.
So that locks that in. I'm sorry.
No, I was just going to say, I was looking at where you're at right now. On my screen, I've got Delta included in my chart, and I see you're working with a Delta right around 10-ish, 0.091, 0.10 is roughly where you're at. So
maybe you can explain to me. I have a brief understanding of Delta, but is Delta important in what I'm doing?
No, it's not. It's just some of us look at Delta, but you're using SD, standard deviations, so six of one, half a dozen of the other.
Okay. I mean, what you're doing is just another way of looking at Delta.
The standard deviation?
Yeah.
Okay. I just want to make sure that, you know, if there's anything I can add to this to make it better.
No, you're doing just fine. I'm sorry for interrupting you.
No problem. So, That's just how I do it. So, you know, I can fiddle around, or anybody can fiddle around with this number until they find their comfort level. And like today, I may or may not put an order in today. Now, this is just my thinking. Somebody might say, well, what are you watching? Do you have all kinds of charts? Well, I have a couple of charts, but I don't know how to read them. You know, I just, they're pretty. They're very pretty. And I can read some of them a little bit. But, I'm a little, for myself, I'm just a little bit bothered by, not so much by this where the S&P is right now, I'm bothered by the futures. And so I will watch the futures a little bit. And the broad market futures still appear to me to be, you know, they're just a little shaky right now. I'd like for them to stabilize. So I'll watch that the rest of the afternoon and see if there's any trend, or even if it settles in around that number, I might be okay.
Yeah.
But I'm not comfortable with that right now. I wouldn't put this trade in right now.
Stay.
Yeah. The other thing, some of the questions that I've had, and I've gotten a lot of response to this thing. I've really been humbly overwhelmed by some of the response, and people want me to call them, and I'm more than willing to do this, and more than willing to help anybody out. A short story is that I owned 5 businesses at one time, not all at once, and 3 independent insurance agencies, 2 financial planning firms. I was a registered investment advisor, and I sold my business in 1999. I couldn't have picked a worse time. We all know the troubles of the early 90s, and then I proceeded over the next 8 years to have 15 surgeries. So I went from being retired to looking up the phone number for the Salvation Army. Not quite that bad, but it's so what I'm doing is I'm trying to rebuild my finances. So I figured, well, if I got something like this and if it has any interest or has any merit at all, I would like to help some folks out. I have a friend of mine that is almost in the same situation. He is very, very deep, dire financial straits. So this is not, I don't perceive this as being for the heavy trader of the $50,000, $200,000 account, unless they want to say, you know what, I'm going to set $10,000 or $20,000 over to the side here, and let's just say $10,000. I figured out that at $10,000, you could probably bring in somewhere around $300 to $350 a week. Well, you know, that's not too shabby. That's golf money and taking your wife out to dinner. And, you know, somebody can just work with it as they want. But this, I don't think this is any big, huge trading model or anything like that.
So what's your pain point, Larry? Where do you cry uncle?
I'm tied up right now.
Good. Excellent question. You'll see, right, what I do is when I put the trade in, let me see where I had to do it up here. I think a couple times in August. Yeah, you see the red in August there. When I put the trade in, let's just say we put this in one we had now, we put it in at 19, whatever that short spread was back here. Yeah. Right here at 1935, I'm going to put in an alert at 1955. Now, that's my 20 points. So
okay.
I want to know when that hits 1925. So it comes to my computer and it comes to my cell phone. I have the program on my iPad so that if I'm away from home,
yep,
I can make any adjustments. So but there are a couple things, I guess, that a person can do here. One, you can put an order in that if the S&P hits a certain number, close out this whole position. Or if the strike.
They're not going to just find you incompetent right away. That would probably years would go by. Well,
Dave, we hear you. Dave, we hear you talking.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear the conversation.
No, that was Dave. It sounded like he was talking to somebody else.
Okay. Somebody might say they want to know when it's 1960 or whatever the number is. Everybody can determine for themselves. For myself, I go out 20 points. And at 20 points, I'll take a look at the market closely. Is it going down for some reason? Now, I do have the only mantra. I shouldn't say the only one. The main mantra that I have in these in any kind of trading is that news trumps everything. News trumps everything. It can be good news or bad news, but it trumps all of the algorithms, all of the studying that goes into it. If something blows up in the Middle East, that trumps everything. So I will take a look at what caused the market to be dropped down to 1955. Was it a slow drop? Was it a precipitous drop? What kind of drop was it? And does it look like it's going to keep going? So I have to decide what I'm going to do. So let's just say, for the sake of this conversation, I'm not comfortable. I think it's going to go down further. There's two things I'm going to do. One is I'm going to close out totally this position. So let's say we took in the 90 cents, and I close it out total, and it, just for the sake of this conversation, it cost me $2.20 to close it out. So now I'm $1.30
okay.
in the hole. Now I can suck up to $1.30, I guess. But what I'm going to probably do is I'm going to do the same calculation that we just did a minute ago and figure the standard deviation on the new SPX price. And I'm going to probably do the same thing, only I'm going to do two contracts. And what I found in each time, and I only had to make three adjustments, I think it was, during the previous year, in each case, the two contracts brought in enough credit to overcome, in my example, the $1.30 loss.
Now, would that be in the same expiration, or would you go out to the next expiration? Okay.
Same expiration. So let's just say that this happened on a Thursday. We only have the rest of Thursday and Friday. So I'm going to fiddle around with these prices and fiddle around with these strike prices until I've done what I can do to at least get the $1.30 back and break even. But in every case that I had to do it, I was able to get more credit. I wasn't able to get the 90 cents back, but I don't care. You know, if I got 40 cents credit, I would be satisfied given the situation.
Okay, because if you got in a situation, you had an increased volatility, which allowed you to try and recoup, plus the doubling up on the contracts.
Yes, that's right. Yeah, there would be more premium, and that's what I found.
Larry,
okay, I've been jeopardizing it. I'll be quiet. Go ahead, Andrew.
This is Ron. Larry, so if you roll down and double up, what happens if you then get 20 to within 20 points of that strike? Are you doing it again?
Yes, but I'll probably pull the trigger a little quicker. Now, I haven't had that happen yet, so I'm kind of hypothetically. If it's that precipitous that it's moving that quickly, I'm going to probably pull the trigger much, much quicker.
And Larry, you're always trading the front week?
Yes. My trades are I think somebody asked a question about how I would have handled yesterday. I'm not in the market on Monday. I go in on Tuesday. So all my trades, this is where I'm at now. I've kind of developed this. All of my trades are basically four-day trades. And usually I'll put them in maybe even about this time to 3 o'clock. So the theta for this day will be gone at 4:15. And now all I got is Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday.
So Larry, do you close the trade on Friday?
No, I don't. And that's a good question because I kind of fiddled around with that a little bit. And for a while, I was a little confused about when the settlement date on these. And I understand the settlement date on these is Friday. Friday evening or Friday afternoon when they close out, that's when the settlement is. And if somebody told me one time it wasn't until Saturday morning, why? That can't be right. There's no trading on Saturday. So, but, you know, there some people, I've read it, some people will say they'll take a point. Let's take this 90 cents. Some folks will say, you know what, if I get 80% of my credit, I'm out of there. So that's, you know, somebody might say that, and there's certainly nothing, this is not a right or wrong thing. Somebody might say if I get 80% or 90 cents, I'm gone. And some people will say, you know what, Friday at 3:30, I'm closing it out for a nickel. And I have done that. Now I'm not quite sure why I've done it because I'm not sure that it's necessary to do that, given the fact that they settle right after the close. And if you're 20 points away from your short strike, why would you want to spend anything at all if you're that close?
And are you keeping your size consistent? I know your example is one lot, and it looked like your trading journal was one lot. Is your plan to always just trade one lot, or you plan on increasing size, compounding in some fashion?
Yeah, when I build up my trading account and, you know, get back to where I'm financially able to do the things that I used to be able to do, I will probably increase that a little bit. You know, it's one thing for somebody, and I've been in this position, it's one thing when you got a trading account of $500,000 to talk about $10,000 or $20,000. When you don't have anything, you know, and you're trying to build up enough money for you know, just to have some pocket money to move on. And that's the stage I'm in. I'm being quite frank with you that I am at a stage where I'm trying to build my my life and my trading account back up. So I feel like, yes, I lost a lot of stuff. I lost a lot of money. Okay. But one thing I didn't lose, one was my sense of humor, and two is I didn't lose what was in my head. And so I'm hoping that my plans are now is to take and hand this to people for nothing. Just to people that want to get started, people that want to just learn a little bit. I'm just willing to do this for nothing. And out of that, life just has a way of working its way out. Those kinds of things work their way out, and I'm not worried about it. So if anybody wants any help, needs any help, would like to talk to me at any time, I would be more than willing to help anybody out at any time for no charge.
Kaleri, didn't you mention that you had a VIX filter to enter the trade?
Say again.
I think when we talked on the phone, didn't you say you had a filter on the VIX, that the VIX was over like 20, you wouldn't enter the trade that week?
No. No, I still do that. As a matter of fact, I kind of feel, if I was to pick this this VIX, this ideal VIX number, this number that it's at right now is kind of ideal to me. To me, I don't know if that, you know, I'm just saying to me, but I take a look at the VIX and then the implied volatility. So in this case here, the number that goes into that standard deviation calculator is going to be 22.2 because it's higher than the 20.74. Now, if the VIX got up and had, I think it did last year one time or the year before, we had a period where it got up in the 40s or something like that. I don't know. That would make me a little edgy. I'd have to really think that out.
I want to play devil's advocate on this a little bit, guys.
Sure.
This is a parking trade, which was developed by Dave Thomas and his kids 3 or 4 years ago, and
Dave Thomas, the Wendy's Dave Thomas?
No, Dave Thomas out in Seattle, actually is a mentor, an associate mentor with John Locke's outfit.
Okay.
And he was just selling 10 deltas and using about a 20-point vertical credit spread. And he would have two of them on at a time and just go out a couple of weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, and sell the 10 delta and go down about 20 points for the long. And
30 days, Curtis.
Was it? People were all over the map with the.
No, I traded. It's 30 days. I got
right.
I got the presentation. So big difference between 3 and 30.
Yeah, and
yeah.
Also, what happened was that people did really well with it. And then they started doing 10 contracts, 20 contracts, and hitting max loss. And at 20 contracts, you know, your max loss is $20,000. And they got thumped a few times. You know, if you take a max loss, you're taking out 5-6 months of potential profit that you have to make up. And so, as a very small trade, I mean, you can run a Monte Carlo simulator on this trade and see that it has a high probability at these standard deviations. And, you know, I don't think you have to do custom calculations using the VIX or anything like that, just because that's what delta is. It's a probability, a statement of probability based on standard, on implied volatility and standard deviation. So it really is a much happier trade, you know, at 2 or 3 contracts. I think the idea that you could do this and scale it up is what caused people. Dave stopped trading the trade about a year and a half ago, even though he sort of put together the models that people were using. And it's just, it can be very nerve-wracking on a human level and on a trading psychology level. It can really wreck your peace of mind when it goes bad, because when it goes bad, the SPX can and does go down 100 points in 3 days. It was down 50 points yesterday. If you just put that trade on and the next day it went down 50 points, you'd be down $1,200-$1,400 on a one lot. And you would have to decide at that point whether you wanted to take that loss, you know, or roll it out and all that stuff. And if you've got, you know, if you're doing this every week, it's a lot of maintenance, you know. I personally did not have, you know, I tried it now and again just for something to do. But I didn't, psychologically, it was too stressful for me. And the exposure was very real because some of the progenitors of the parking trade rolled out of this strategy just because they couldn't make it make sense when they took a really big loss. You know, they would have to do 5 months times 4 trades. That's 20 trades to make back the money that they lost. You see what I'm saying?
Before, yeah, I do. And I'm just kind of thinking out loud that one of the things I did, and actually one of the stimulants for me at the beginning or at the end of last year when I started getting into this was, you know, everybody knows about Karen, the super trader. And she was doing iron condors. And I had done iron condors in the past before I got sick and had all the surgeries. And actually, I didn't do too bad at the iron condors, and I really liked them a lot. And I'm just thinking out loud that maybe, you know, if I built up, let's just say I built up some kind of account, that I probably at the max of this would maybe go 5 or 10 contracts and then take any additional monies that I was able to save up and go into the iron condor world because I'm familiar with it and I really like the iron condors.
Well, that's a road that most of us have been down, Tom, and you know, you can do that, but you have to understand that there are management issues in the iron condor and trading psychology issues that make it a very dangerous trade in certain kinds of markets. You know, we were trading iron condors back in 2006 and 2007, and we would just put on these huge iron condors and, you know, make several thousand dollars and think we had discovered the Holy Grail. But then, you know, you would have a month where you would lose 20 or 30,000 just because you did not bail at a max loss point, you know, which is, again, a psychological pitfall where you say, no, it'll come back. It's gone down. It's at support, et cetera. You know, all the reasons that we decide not to take a max loss, you know, in my case, you know, it was devastating to have 9 months of profitable trades and then have one trade 1 month that took out, you know, 5 or 6 months of profitability, and that is the danger in this trade. You can't like present this to people and give it to them as a simple, easy way to make money, because that does not exist in options trading. The risk is very real, and a time will come when you will take a big loss in this trade, and it will make you rethink it. You know.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah, Larry, you initially posted in the forum for some feedback, and I think everybody or most people that are in this in that community, we've all kind of done what I call probability trading. We've all done some form or fashion of what you're doing, the iron condor, just as Curtis was saying. And for the most part, we've all evolved away from that because, quite frankly, what you're doing in the long term will not work. I can almost guarantee it.
I agree.
I'm not trying to bust your bubble. What I'm really would try to encourage is that you evolve away from that and maybe look at some of the other strategies that that we do in the community, because Curtis basically outlined it. I'm going to go ahead and say it. You probably got lucky. I've done trades similar to this where I did a one-day trade. I'd sell a credit spread on Thursday and let it expire on Friday. I know a guy that did what you're doing. Basically, he sold a little bit more time. He had 6% returns for 24 straight months, thought he was the greatest trader in the world, raised $10 million, and proceeded to lose half of it the next 3 months.
Wow.
So you can have long stretches of success and winners, but that doesn't really mean anything. And I know that's hard for a lot of people to get their arms around. Well, a win is a win is a win. The money's in my account. Well, probability-based trading like this just doesn't work over the long term.
What is a better way to go?
Well, I kind of think of options trading in sort of two schools of thought. You're either a probability trader, which is you're basing everything on delta, standard deviation, anything that has to do with probability. And that's sort of what Tasty Trade bases all their philosophy on. Trade small, trade often. And, you know, they're trying to take advantage of the probabilities in the long term. What most people in this community do is we trade sort of based on not based on probability. It's a John Locke. I don't know if you've heard of him and his concepts. A lot of us sort of gravitate towards that. It's basically what it is. It's some sort of a butterfly or condor structure underneath the market And if you look at the risk profile, that's sort of a what we call a profit tent. And then there's various ways to manage the trade over time. And it's still income trading, which is sort of what you're doing, but it's not based on probability. And those systems have been proven out over time by many of his students and followers. So I would try to encourage you to move in that direction and evolve away from probability trading. And believe me, we all have been exactly where you're at. And you think, wow, you know, don't buy options, let's sell options. I want to be the house and in the casino, right, and not the gambler. And that's sort right of step one. And I know that we've all been, like I said, I sound like a broken record. We've all been down this road where, I've had years and you're like, yeah, this worked. It's awesome. I just do this Iron Condor thing. And it just, quite frankly, that's why communities like this started, because that didn't work and we were all looking for an alternative.
What is it that made Karen the super trader so successful?
I don't think she's telling you everything she's doing.
I agree, and I don't know that she's that successful, really.
And that exactly.
She's selling naked shorts a lot of the time and sort of moving them and buying longs. She's doing a lot of things besides just an Iron Condor.
Exactly. And she's doing what's called portfolio margin. If you have an account that's over $125,000, your broker will allow you to sell options naked and not charge as much margin. There's obviously pluses and minuses to doing that. But the bottom line is the Karen strategy, and I went down that road too when she first came out. She's the superstar. And, you know, you got to remember Tom's trying to not Nunamaker, but Sosnoff over at Tasty Trade. They're marketing. They're promoting. You know, you got to remember there's certain agendas embedded in there. I'm not saying they're nefarious, but they're business related. And she certainly she's not telling you everything she's doing.
Well, I think she also.
Well, I always thought it was kind of interesting that they would have her on there and she would tell them what they're doing and they would praise her up and down on one side.
Yeah.
But that's not what they were doing.
Like, yeah. Well, and what did that do? That drove a lot of eyeballs to their site and a lot of people opened up new accounts with Thinkorswim.
Well, I think she also martingales her positions.
And she martingales her positions. And again, I don't think we know everything that she's doing. Well, that's where it's like when you're gambling, you lose, you just double your bet, you lose, you double your bet again. Eventually, you'll hit a winner, and you'll make up all your losers.
Larry, this is Dan. This is Dan Harvey. I've been listening to some of your discussions and some of the comments here, and I have to admire you for stepping up to the plate on this. It takes a lot of courage after I came in on the tail end of your introduction, but I'm afraid I have to agree more along the lines with Curtis. I think in the final analysis done over time, these types of trades are going to be losers. And here's what I would recommend. The only way to satisfy yourself that this could be a winning strategy would be to do an expectancy study. And since we haven't talked before, I don't know if you know the concept of positive expectancy, but there's lots written about it. It's a fairly easy concept. It's the way that the casinos make all their money because they're the house. But basically, you'd have to do a lot of backtesting, and you'd have to determine your win ratio, and you have to determine the average win and the average loss. And from that information, you can arrive at the expectancy of the trade, which means basically that if you did the trade 1,000 times, what's going to be your the average win? And if you have a very low expectancy, that means that you're going to have some big drawdowns. And if you do something to minimize your drawdowns, like if you were trading futures, for example, you would set a stop, well, that's going to cut your win rate, because what you've experienced so far is, like some people have said, you've you've had a very, very high win rate, but once you have a big drawdown, that's going to be an eye opener. And what happens then to most people? They say, well, okay, I just will put a stop in place. But once you do that, then that will decrease the win rate. And so that is where doing an expectancy study would come into play.
Are there programs for that?
Well, you can just set up a spreadsheet to calculate your expectancy. You might want to read a little something about it and see how the numbers are calculated. And I see you're pretty good with spreadsheets. And you just set up a backtest type of spreadsheet, which will then automatically calculate the expectancy.
Okay.
Yeah, well, Dan, what was that website that we used to use, the Monte Carlo simulator? That's pretty easy to do it.
Yeah, that is, I think I have it.
Haven't used it in a while.
I think it's on the CAPD website, isn't it? Did Nunamaker include that tool?
He might have. It is.
Yeah, I seem to remember building a tool like that.
Yeah.
There's one online where you can just fill in the live fields.
But it's called Option Risk, and I can't seem to get the. Wait a minute. Okay. No, I thought I had it.
Yeah, Tom, while he's looking at that, go back and backtest in 2008, in the fall of 2008, when there were 3 days in that six-week period where we had five standard deviation moves, three different days where there were five standard deviation moves in one day, which is mathematically impossible. It's like infinity, you know? It doesn't exist
right.
In the mathematical world, but it happened. You know, it's incalculable, basically.
So once in a lifetime event.
Larry,
three times in 6 weeks is not once in a lifetime.
Once every 7 years is probably more like it. 5 to 7 years.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah.
Larry, if you want, you can get a free trial to Option View, which will allow you to, you know, spend a couple of weeks with the program. You can go back and backtest. You know, through 2008, 2009, and you see how this strategy performs in extraordinary markets rather than ordinary markets.
Yeah, and I really, really appreciate all of this input. One of the problems I have is that I don't financially exist. You know, I'm not in your world. I am starting from square one, so, you know, to take and buy anything is... It's just out of my parameters right now. I just can't do it until I build up a trading account. So I really, really am starting out from square one. So it may just be that this is a pipe dream for me.
That I can't
do this.
Well, I think you're going down the path that we have all been down on, So you're on the right path. It's just that. If you go through this back testing and figure your expectancy and go through those exercises and conclude that this is not a long-term strategy for you, then you'll just evolve this like all of us. So please don't get discouraged. None of us want to see you blow up this account or anybody blow up their account, especially if they're in a in a situation you're describing. But I would encourage you to maybe look at the road trip trade, which is a presentation that Tom is going to do, I believe, tomorrow, and maybe start to evaluate some of the trades that we do in this community that are a lot less risk that can bring in similar dollars. It's not going to be the fantastic, you know, return on capital numbers, which, quite frankly, doesn't mean anything. That's a different discussion, but I would just encourage you to, you know, find your peace with this. Set up one way or the other. I think you've heard what our recommendations are, and maybe look at some of these somebody had mentioned in the chat, there's some alert services on capital discussions. There's a weirdor strategy, which is sort of an iron condor kind of a strategy, which you're familiar with. I'm just trying to give you some ideas of where you can go for square. You're on square one, where to go for square two.
Don't forget the core income that Dan gave right before the Christmas break.
From Theta Trend.
Yeah, the core income butterfly. It's very similar
to
the M3.
Okay, yeah, I didn't see that one. So, yeah, I'm just trying to get if anybody has some other ideas.
I feel that even though I may not like it, that you have saved me perhaps a year or two of heartache and maybe even worse, you know, that I need to move away. I need to move away from this and look into other things, that which may or may not be possible for me. Let me ask you a question. To be part of this group two group here, do you have to pay for this to belong to this?
Nope, this is free, Larry.
This is free. Okay. So do you get a different sign in every time?
There's a new password. It's password protected. So if we do ever want to protect it in the future, we can. But you know, anybody who logs into our member site has access to it. So you're more than welcome and encouraged to join us every week.
I appreciate that. And you're putting on a presentation tomorrow?
Tomorrow at 4:30 Eastern. So that'll be, again, in the same calendar on our member site. You can log into it. And I'll make sure you get the email for that so that you get the login right away in your inbox.
Do you archive those?
Yes. When you log in the member site in the library, all those recordings are available.
Okay. Because I have a doctor's appointment at 4:30.
Hey, Curtis, Dan, and Tom, you guys are the what I consider the gurus. What would you recommend to him for next steps if he wanted to evolve as a options trader? I'm just curious.
Well, I'll tell you what I would recommend. Larry, given what I heard you say, you know, earlier about your situation, I would recommend strongly one of the lower risk, less stressful trades. I will tell you that with my road trip butterfly, not that I'm necessarily touting that, because there are several butterfly variants that are somewhat similar. You know, yesterday, you know, even though we were down at one point 460 points on the Dow, my butterflies were all making money. And the downside of my trade, that, and also many of the other butterflies and also weirdors, the downside is that they're not super quick like you're doing now. I mean, that's the appeal of the style of trade that you're doing. The number of days in the trade is very small. You're in, you're out. But that carries with it a very high attendant risk, namely a very large drawdown. I mean, you're looking at a potential drawdown on a single lot of maybe $3,000. From the trade that I understand that you showed, as I understand it, maybe more. So that's going to really cut your expected return. And let's see, Tom, I have my little spreadsheet about expected return up, if you want me to very briefly show that. Do you want to show? Do you want me to show that?
I just have to put on the list of attendees here. Hang on a second. Oh, there you are.
So I'm ready to hit share now?
Passing presenter privilege. You should be ready now.
Okay. You know, I can send you this if you like. There are lots of, you know, spreadsheets available on expected return, but this is this is like an expected return in reverse. You start out with whatever margin that you're utilizing. I have 10,000 here. This is just for teaching purposes. And let's say that as a percentage of that margin, you're looking to make an expected return of 4.7. So that would be, you're trying to make $470 for every 10,000, right?
Mm-hmm.
And there it is right there. You're looking to make 470 for your 10,000. So you plug in here your average profit, which is 5.5, 550, and that's, of course, if you're doing well. And this is your average loss. You have to win a total of 89% of the time to generate that expected return. But when you change these around, let's say that you were trying to make six, but you found out that you were having some losers. You didn't really change that. You didn't really change this number that much, but you did increase the allowed losing months. And let's say that you're not able to achieve the six. Let's say you only have an average profit of five. Well, now you have to beat this system nearly 100% to be able to generate the desired expected return. So this goes back to what I was saying. Whenever you start to set a stop to minimize your drawdown, that's going to affect all these numbers. So
what's the period of time for this particular trade?
This is not based on time.
Okay.
This is just the mathematics of expected return.
Okay.
I think
it's 12 trades a year.
Pardon me?
It's 12 trades a year, right?
Right. Yeah. This number, yes, is based on 12 trades a year. Yes.
Okay.
But I think if you read a few of the articles on expected return, you know, particularly if you saw how that actually, you know, related to simple casino games. I know I have done a webinar in the past, you know, relating this to roulette, for example. This is the way that the casinos make their money. They're the house, and they have this all calculated down. They know what their drawdown is, and they set the game so that they get a good expected return. So from your situation, yeah, things are going really good for you now, and these are short-term trades, and you're making money. But, you know, once, like Curtis said, once you get the big drawdown, that is going to rock your world. So many people in the community, as was already said, are going to a butterfly type of trade. Just as an example, here's one of my road trips, and nothing happened yesterday. I put this on, you know, some time ago, and I will, you know, take this off in about a week. It should make a couple thou. And this is with a margin of only about, I'd say, $7,000 on average for this trade. So the returns are anywhere from, you know, from 20 to 35%. The downside is, like all butterflies or nearly all butterfly strategies, you know, you have to be in the trade for a long time to get your money because you're taking advantage of the trade being positive theta. So that's the trade-off. I mean, you go for the flashy trades like some people do, like, you know, the straddles and the earnings plays, and if you win, you look like a trading god. But when you do these 1,000 times, like I have over the years, or more, I mean, I've been doing this for about, you know, 25 years, so I guess many more than 1,000 times, you do go through these periods of very large drawdowns, and they're extremely painful. I know one guy that it actually wrecked his entire life and his entire family. And I'm sure other people in the community know people like that. So these are the kinds of things you want to consider. Again, I have to admire you for you know, stepping up to the plate, but you want to see the big picture here, okay?
Yeah, that's why I really appreciate the feedback. On your graph here, do I understand correctly that in spite of yesterday, that was basically a non-factor to you? You never dropped down below the zero line?
No, I mean, no, not at all. In fact, this one made money yesterday. All of them, I mean, this is another one here. All of them are making money here. But you see, what I have here, these are different expirations.
Uh-huh.
So this one yesterday was down here in terms of where the black dot is, but I still made money because, as you see from the graph, you can see from the day step curves. So
right.
This a type of trade, which is a butterfly type of trade, you have a very wide range of profitability, sometimes up to 160 points. And I think you can see on your 3 or 4 day trade, you know, obviously you're not going to be able to take a 160 point move in the S&P. You might be able to handle a 50 point move, but if you stayed in the trade after a 50 point move to the downside, you would be feeling a world of hurt. And what you would find is that there's only one way that this is going to come out good, and that's if the market, you know, suddenly reverses. And sometimes it does. Sometimes it just gets worse. And then you're really in a world of hurt. And this is where, you know, people like Karen the Super Trader, see, this is where they get in trouble because they martingale their system. But now the way that Karen can get away with this is that she's a multimillionaire. So she can simply, you know, hedge these off, and she can roll them down forever. But I can't do that, and I suspect that you can't do that. And you know,
I've done
some
of these trades. You think is she being disingenuous?
Well, I don't know about that. I can't really speak to that. I don't think so, but I don't think, as somebody mentioned, I'm not sure who it was, I don't think we are hearing the big picture.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also remember that Karen did not trade during the recession. She started trading late 2011.
That is correct. Yeah. So
she
would have been wiped out.
She started 2011?
No, late in 2011.
Oh, late 2011. Okay.
So she would have been wiped out at the end of 2008 and the start of 2009. She'd have been wiped out.
It's easy to sell put spreads in a bull market, but try it in a bear market.
Yeah.
Hey, Dan, I want to echo the sentiment that, Larry, we really appreciate you bringing this in front of us, because we don't talk enough about risk, and it's brave that you are letting yourself be vulnerable and hearing feedback like this. I really appreciate that. I really do.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think
I entered into this thing thinking, well, maybe I had something to show people that they, you know, again, I'd never been in one of these rooms before, these chat rooms. I know nothing about them. And so I thought, well, maybe I can come in here and show this and just see if there's any feedback, and perhaps I can help some people that might need help. But I need help myself. But now I see that I need to back off of this thing way. And where I wanted to be a mentor, I can see now that I need a mentor. So this whole thing is gotten all twisted around in about an hour's time. It's just, I put a pin in my balloon, but that's okay. That's okay. I appreciate that.
One of the things that's fun is that is the actual moniker parking trade. that Dave Thomas and his family developed a version of this a few years ago. And that was that his daughter named it a parking trade because it cost her 20 bucks a day to park in downtown Seattle to go to work. And she just wanted to make enough to pay for her parking.
I didn't know that, Curtis. That's funny.
Yeah.
Isn't that fun? I like it.
So one
I'd like
lie,
to make the 20
know,
bucks and have no parking.
There you go. There you go.
Well, Larry, I think if you were to adopt some kind of butterfly, I mean, the one that you're seeing on the screen here is what I call the road trip. I think Tom's going to talk about it tomorrow and give a detailed discussion of it. Right, Tom? You know, I call it the road trip because you don't really do anything for about 30 days, which means you can be on the road, as I have been with this trade on, and didn't even have my laptop. So it's only after about 30 days that you want to start managing the P&L. But the advantage of this, you know, I always hesitate to use the term or the phrase, well, it's like an ATM machine. But actually it nearly is. You know, it nearly is if you're willing to have several of these on at a time, as I do. You saw there I have about, you know, five of them on. So that would be only about, you know, 35, maybe 40,000 a margin that I use on these trades. And I look for each one of them to generate somewhere between 1,500 and 2,000. You can see the one that I have here, which is the January 5 trade, meaning it expires on the January 5 cycle. See, that's already up around 1,500. I'm going to pull a few more hundred out. And this thing started, again, with about, well, this is an 8-lot, so this actually would have been about, this would have been about maybe a little over 8,000. But, you know, generating, we'll say, 2,000, and you put up 8,000, see, that's a, you know, that's a very good yield. And several of the butterfly strategies are like this. They're low maintenance, they're low risk, they're you know, very resilient. Like I say, you know, yesterday, every single one that I have on made money. And that's the appeal of this, but the downside is you have to sit on them, and the first couple weeks, it's like watching paint dry because, you know, $30 will trickle in, you know, $50 will trickle in every day, and then it's only later on in the trade that you start making, you know, $150, $200, $300 every day, and then you take it out. So you might want to look into that.
On this particular one you have on the screen, how much capital is at risk?
That would have started at a little more than 8,000 because it's an 8-lot. The way that I set these up, it is 1,000 per lot. So if you had a 2-lot, which would be a 2-4-2, that would be 2,000, and you should expect to make, oh, I don't know, maybe 500-600 on that.
Hey, Dan Harvey, can I ask you a question?
Dan, it looks like a 6-lot with two vertical put debit spreads.
I actually put a couple of teenies on this.
Hey, Dan.
I think this has this. No, you're right. No, I'm sorry. Yes, this one also has two debit spreads, which I put on some time ago when we were moving down a little bit.
Dan, would you have the time at all to perhaps teach me some of this, or do you not do that?
What I
Tom's doing a presentation tomorrow.
If I put you on the spot, I'm sorry.
Well, no, that's okay. I mean, the reason that I hesitated is that I used to be a mentor, and I no longer do that. But Tom is going to be giving this presentation tomorrow. I'm going to try to join in, although Tom doesn't need me. But so what I would recommend, Larry, is that you look at this trade, you look at the presentation, and you study the trade, and maybe there are some similar strategies, and see if you can't be sold on the concept of a butterfly type of trade.
Okay. Okay. Yeah, tomorrow I have a I'll have to watch it in the archive because I have a doctor's appointment at 4:30.
Well, watch it in the archive, and then if you have any, so I'll tell you what, if you have any questions after that, you can send me an email. I don't know that I can, quote, teach you the strategy, but I can certainly guide you.
Okay. I appreciate
but
that.
But I no longer do actual mentoring. I just don't do that anymore.
No, we do
have there's the archives for Trading Group 2 on the website, and Dan actually presented this trade just a few weeks ago. So if you go to the Capital Discussions website into Trading Group 2 and look through the archives, you'll find a session where he spent about a half hour going over this trade.
Okay, so that's in Group 2 archives?
Yes.
Correct.
Okay. Tom, is there any way that you could bring over that seminar that I did on expectancy to Capital Discussion?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, if you could bring that over, I've had several positive comments on that webinar. In fact, many, not tooting my own horn, but what I'm saying is it's a basic type of presentation which explains the concept of expectancy, starting from the point of view that the audience knew nothing about it, which at the time that I gave that, I think, was largely true. There are several academic articles about it. Some of them, many of them, are more mathematical, and some are beyond my level of mathematics. But what I tried to do was to break it down into a simple concept, you know, relating it to laws of probability, gambling, that sort of thing. You know, to really get a feel for what it takes to generate a positive expectancy. So if Tom brings that over, you might want to view that webinar as well.
Okay. Hey, Dan, that's when you did philosophy and probability.
I will find it for you, Tom, and I will tell you. Don't think that was it. But I will find it.
Do many of you folks use this option view?
Yeah, most of us either use option view or option and explore, and many use thinkorswim, but it doesn't have the back testing capabilities.
Hey Tom, I'm going to make a can I make a point about thinkorswim for a minute?
Sure.
ThinkOrSwim and TD Ameritrade goes on road shows known as Market Drive by TD Ameritrade. And it's timely because this Saturday, especially for those who live in Southern California and specifically Anaheim, they're going to be on the road. And the value to that is not Tom Sosnoff and Don Kaufman, all those guys in the main room, but in a hallway, TD Ameritrade has their programmers on huge screens. They open up their systems, and they're all day long. And you can spend hours and hours. In fact, I missed it last year, but 2 years ago, John Hart was there all day long, answered all the questions, especially all the questions we've had in this room about thinkorswim's methodologies, how they calculate volatility on the different tabs. It's calculated different on a monitor tab than it is on the analyze tab. And you're there live with him for hours as opposed to being on an 800 number and getting knocked off in 5 minutes because of time constraints. It's proven to be very helpful for me, and I just wanted to point that out to anyone who's in the area this Saturday afternoon.
Well, everyone, we've gone over, but this is a fantastic meeting and a great way to start 2016. So, any last points before we wrap up today?
I noticed that somebody had a post on here that they told, where did I see that? Told Tom Sosnoff or something that, Also, I was told by Tom Sofnoff himself that she, I'm assuming Karen, will eventually blow up. So.
Yeah, Charles Cottle basically had a similar prediction. And I posted a link to a video where he went through the trade, and he said back when he was trading on the floor in Chicago, they had something called the O'Hare trade. And that was if you put on a big position, you pack your bags, get out of the country, go to the airport and call back and see how your trade did. And if it blew up, you got on the plane and left the country. If it didn't, you came back home. And he said that's kind of what Karen's doing.
Well, I really, really appreciate you guys. I really appreciate you guys letting me come on and talk about this. And I have learned a lot. I really have learned a lot that I need to, where I thought that I was going to be kind of showing you something. I can see there's nothing new. You guys have all been down this road. And I will explore the idea of the butterfly, Dan. That really looks intriguing to me. And I'll have to spend some time studying it.
Well, good luck to you, Larry.
Thank you very much.
Thanks again, everyone. Philip asked the date of that.
How often do you have these meetings?
Every week, Larry.
Tuesday at 12.
Yep.
Okay.
All right, then.
What was the thing? I saw something on there. In order to be part of a group, you had one was you got some benefits, and the other one you had to pay $12.50, and you got some additional benefits. Is that?
Yeah, that's just so you can download all the extra files, help support the site, turn out the ads, things like that. So it's, we appreciate it if you want to jump in and help us, but, it's not required.
Okay. Well, thanks again. I appreciate it.
All right. Thanks, everyone. We will see you next week, and I'll be presenting tomorrow at 4:30 and hope you can join. It should be a good, another good meeting to start the year. So thanks, everyone.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Tom.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.